focused on wind energy, we're focused on clean energy, we're focused on, you know, we shouldn't just be installing solar panels. I had an interesting meeting with somebody from Tesla who was here saying, great, you know, we're doing all this great work with solar panels here in Houston, and I said, well, what are you doing? Well, they're installing them. And so they have a couple of offices where people have an office manager job. And I said, well, we've got a lot of engineers here, and we've got a lot of people who can create things. Like, why aren't we designing solar panels here? Why aren't we doing more of that? And of course, we do know that some of the things that we do in the transmission of any kind of energy are still settled dreams. You've got to negotiate rights of way, whether you're moving you know, wind energy or you're moving, you know, oil or pipeline. So there are a lot of transferable skills over time. But Houston is the energy capital of the world. I think we need to look around at what the world is demanding. We need to look at the Paris Climate Accord and see that the rest of the world and the markets are moving in other directions that will pay for cleaner and greener energy. And we want to meet that demand for cleaner. And I think that there's a way to do that. I think there's a way to be smart to encourage responsible operators while we are still, you know, focused on drilling for fossil fuels. We want responsible operators. We want to do it in a way that's environmentally conscious. And it is possible to live here and love the environment. So we want to keep the water clean and the sky clear. And those are the kinds of things that we do need to be able to do here. We need to be able to talk about it. We shouldn't be pitting the oil and gas business because wanting to take care of people. Because if we don't take care of people, we won't have anything. So we need to make sure that we are having that conversation and not making a false choice that you can't be one and not the other. Yes. Oh, sorry.
What's your
report?
Well, go ahead. I always have to go in first, and then we'll jump in back and we'll wrap up.
Well, I was just curious. You know, one of the issues that I've noticed is Republicans are always conservative party. And I think lately what we've seen is an increasing environment of competing priorities. So you talk about the VA. You talk about everybody wants to fully fund the VA, everybody wants to fully fund the DOD. Everybody wants to fully fund Medicare. Everybody wants to make sure everyone has health care. Everybody wants to give everything to everyone. I'm just curious, as you go around the district, you wrote the district priorities. Obviously you've heard nationally about the national priorities from the party. Running the primary against a very progressive candidate. How would you, when you get to DC, how do you discern between what's going to be your priority and what isn't? Because ultimately, you know, those are votes. People say, well, if you're not funding my priority, I'm voting for someone else. And how do you keep that, you know, what's your moral compass when it comes to what the priorities of the government should be in the budgeting process, and even in appropriation?
Yeah, I think that's a that's one of the priorities that I've heard from a lot of voters on the trail. But I'm interested to hear what you think the priority should be, and maybe when we're not in the group, I'm happy to chat with more and to hear from you. That's one of the things that I see about John Culberson. I mean, Michael said it. He's never here. I've never seen him in this district until this year and 2008 when he had his tough election. But he doesn't spend time here. His family's in Virginia. He lives in D.C. He hasn't come back to campaign really until this summer. And I think that shows in what he chooses to prioritize in Washington. And I've heard from more people than I can count. They can't get through his office. They can't hear from him. And that they're just not getting the things that they are entitled to get from their representatives in Congress. You had a question.
Yeah.
Last question.
How do you think about the intersection of protecting sensible gun rights and at the same time protecting children and school, given the world of the current limits?
Yeah. I think it's a great question. I think it shows that we are all capable of complex thought here, because I talk to people every day who say, I like the NRA, but I also think that we should lock up our guns. I'm fine with passing a background check. For me, I took the NRA gun safety classes when I was a kid, and I have my expert medal in riflery. But I also believe that we just need common sense gun safety regulations that are going to be effective, the most effective, kind of smartest thing that we can do. And I think a lot of Americans agree. There is like 96% of Americans agree that we should be more self-protection. That seems like something that would be easy. And in fact, John Cornyn introduced a bill in the Senate for universal background checks. When it got sent to the House, John Culberson introduced it, but instead of just introducing a clean bill, passed background checks after the shooting of several Americans. Instead, he added concealed carry reciprocity, which is very contentious. There isn't the same widespread agreement. And he torpedoed the bill. It didn't pass. And we didn't have the background check agreement because what Culberson did to the bill. I think that's an example of what we shouldn't be doing in Washington, because we should find agreement when we can, and we should fight about the things we can agree on. That's something that I've learned in my practice as a lawyer. I mean, lawyers get a lot of grief, but the truth is, part of what we do is build consensus all the time, and we find things that we can agree on, and we fight over things we need to fight over. And if we did more of that in Washington instead of fighting over everything, we might actually be able to see some progress.
Thanks, everyone. We have another half hour sort of mingle and socializing with you. If anyone speaks a little bit about how much you'll be here for a while before taking off to my bachelor's in the evening.
Thank you, Lizzie.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
I'm not sure. Yeah,
of not only that and the trauma and her kids' trauma, which showed up 6 months later,
but also dealing with her insurance company, figuring out whether to sell her house and move, whether to renovate it and what to do. Like, she's a smart lawyer. She's as good as it gets in terms of people who I know who are just good at tackling problems. And if you ever want to do it, and just having to get through all of that stuff and make the emotional decisions, but also the financial and other decisions, and to do the writing, because this isn't enough, you know. I don't think that everyone has that background and ability and the resources and the time to come up with something out of the court. And so, you know, people are dealing with this on a very regular basis. I have cousins who flooded who worry every time it rains about going out. And we had dinner one night and they canceled because it was starting to rain and we're getting a little bit nervous. We want to be able to get home. So I think it's something people are living with. And it's a place where Culberson is clearly failed. But I do think that we've got a lot of smart, good people here wanting to solve the problem, but we need the money. Now we've got it. And we'll be able to get it.
It's a big price tag. You talk about where we spend money in the right places, the right priorities, and that's...
Exactly. No.
There's my two cents.
Well, that's helpful. I appreciate it.
I might have missed what you said, but can you go more in depth on what you would do for...
Thank you so much. Great to meet you. I'm sorry. I just missed it.
Oh, yeah. Can you go more in depth on what you would do to address our flooding concerns? I know you can ask questions.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I've talked to a handful of people. If you know some of the environmental lawyers and various folks, and there are a lot of proposals out there, but it seems like, you know, challenges, that there's no one answer. Right? We need more detention. We need to redraw the floodplain maps to make sure that they're accurate, and then that's going to mean a whole lot of people need flood insurance.
Right.
Because basically, what's the 500-year floodplain is probably the 100-year floodplain. I know that Harris County Flood Control has projects in all of the watersheds in Houston, and those are great, and some of them will help move things along. But ultimately, you know, you've got to find detention. You've got to speed up Project Braze and get it finished. Now we finally have the money to do it, but that's languished because of the funding structure for a long time. We need immediate repairs to Attucks and Barker. That's been on the list for a long time to repair places of the earthen dam. That seems like a no-brainer. There's some other questions that are tricky, like should you dredge the silt in Attucks and Barker? There's some discussion of doing that, and then there are other people who say you should just get new drainage elsewhere because that won't create enough acre feet to make a difference. Mm-hmm. So like there's some linear detention they're doing along Terry Hershey Park. I don't know if y'all have seen that, but they're creating a new detention. Detention's the number one thing, and needing to do it kind of everywhere. Needing to finish the projects that we have should get largely funded by the bond. There's not as much money for buyouts. I think some buyouts would be useful and important, and I think they're kind of countervailing forces on that. One of the things a lot of people talk about that I'm still talking to experts and other people about is the idea of the third reservoir. A lot of people liked that initially. Now I think people have scaled back from that because the third reservoir was designed in a way to add to development, to be able to develop. And a lot of people prefer to keep sort of the native prairie grasses and the native prairie, and that that's better detention. And also that, like, the third reservoir that's currently designed, it will help the Attucks, but the Barker. So I think the answer to that is Harris County Flood Control is going to study it and figure out what they can do and whether there's a way. Somebody explained it to me, and it was a great way to say it. You can build like a giant another reservoir. You can build a dollar, or you can have like 10 dollars. So kind of thinking what's best for the community, what's best for the environment, what's the best way to do it.
Because it is sad. It was sad when Harvey hit.
Where were y'all?
Well, we were in the southeast area.
But my grandmother lost her house. My grandmother lost her house, my aunt lost her house.
Where we were, it was like our street didn't flood, but around us,
everything did.
So we saw all of our family and our friends, they were affected. And it was hard because we weren't, but we felt.
Right. But yeah, well, and you want to help them. But so hard. I mean, water damage is so pervasive, so bad. It's like, you know, it can be very So, I don't know, what do y'all see in terms of projects or things that you think make sense, either on something side or just in general?
I'm just trying to get
clear on what needs to be done. I think there's, so Jim Blackburn is a scientist at Rice, and he's put out a couple of papers on what we should do about flooding, and he's really, he's an expert. He's been studying it for a long time. So, and I think he published them through the Baker Institute, so that's a really, you can go online and just pull up his papers. And I've been talking to him a lot, actually, since the beginning of the campaign, before Harvey, about flooding. And he, you know, he's always been kind of the environmental lawyer, like fighting the Grand Parkway and all that stuff. So that's kind of, that's his perspective coming in, but I think he also understands a lot about changing climate and what's going to happen and, you know, what that means for us and coming up with smart solutions. You know, what they did on Project Graves, they created like the little water hole. Have you been there? It's like, it's detention, it's overflow detention created. Sometimes it's like a lovely park, you know, and people run their dogs and have, you know, all kinds of events and stuff down there. It's like a big meadow. But when it floods, Braes Bio like has just detention off on the side. The problem on Braes Bio is that, and I've studied obviously what's in the district more than the rest of town, but on Braes Bio there's no rustic deck. It's so developed that what they're talking about is potentially buying golf courses and stuff like that. Yeah, that's contentious. I've been up in Jersey Village and they're talking about, they have two golf courses in their community and they've been talking about turning them into detention. So it's ideas like that that are kind of local, get everybody on board. The other thing is, you know, part of the drainage issue is we only have so much that can get out of the Gulf so fast. We don't have a whole lot of there's not a lot of drop from one side of it, from the highest point in Harris County to Galveston Bay. It's like a couple inches. You know, it's really small. And so, you know, we're relying on gravity to move it all out. And we have to, so a lot of times you have to back up trains. My friend Charles, who's a lawyer and a flooding guy who has been involved in multiple flooding-related lawsuits and is now the lead lawyer in the Addicts and Barker upstream litigation. So the people not who got flooded after they opened the dam, so the people who live in the reservoirs, basically, and didn't know it. He's working for them, and he always says, like, everybody is just one backed up drain away from having so making sure that we have good drainage maintenance, which isn't the flood control district, it's the city, you know, making sure everybody's working together. But there's no, you know, easy, there's no easy answer.
I'm just starting, well, we're both just starting to get into politics. Everything that's been going on, we're trying to get out there.
Mm-hmm.
And I found it interesting that you said that Colbison's not really doing anything.
Well, he's campaigning now, but he really hasn't been around for a long time. I mean, he's kind of out and saying, oh, I got money for Harvey recovery, but that's his job. I mean, that's like the basis.
Right.
But I think that he just hasn't been actively participating and partnering in our community in a long time. But I think that there are a lot of good, smart people here who want to work hard and find solutions. And I think that if everybody works together and plays in position, right, you need flood control to figure out their stuff. And you need the city to work on the drainage. And you need the federal government to come in with funding and the Army Corps of Engineers to be there for it. Everybody's got a part to play. But everybody's got to work together doing it. Yeah. So that's interesting that y'all are just getting involved in politics.
I mean, in college, and, you know, through the beginning of my career, I didn't really pay too much attention, but now it's all the recent events. I'm like, maybe I should start.
So what do you do now?
I'm a teacher.
Okay, great. What do you teach?
Second grade.
Oh, great. Wonderful. What about you?
I work at CenterPoint Energy.
Oh, terrific. Okay.
Electrician.
Okay,
yeah,
great.
So when I was in Florida, when the Florida hurricane happened, I was over there trying to help them. So.
Well, I was in Virginia when we had a hurricane. Are you leaving? All right, it's good to see you. Do you have a number? Hello, Ira.
Nice to meet you.
Yes, it's so nice to meet you. I won't trap you guys. It was really nice meeting you. Thank you so much. Take care.